Hey, what's going on, guys? This is the Edge DFS. We're coming to you on Monday night, recording this video for good old Tuesday night football, Cowboys versus Ravens. My name is Tyson Smith, joined by Ellie Hernandez. Ellie, what's going on, man? How were your lineups today? How did you fare today?
I didn't do too well overall in Showdown. I had a lot of the right calls. Unfortunately, I was heavy on Antonio Gibson in the first game, and he didn't get any run because of his injury. Had a decent amount of James Washington, so that was cool. It's just a little more frustrating when you don't win and you got some low-owned dude like that go up. But it's fun watching Washington win. And then tonight was just a shit show for me. So I missed out on the Jeff Wilson play. So
you and everybody else. I feel like we did a pretty good job on our video breaking this game down. I feel like everything we said kind of worked out, although it's just hard with the 49ers, random ass dudes scoring touchdowns and shit. Ayuk did pretty good randomly. Bourne stepped up at the end. There's a lot of garbage time points in this game, especially that end touchdown there to Jordan Reed. That kind of ruined things. All right, well, let's talk about another game here. We got another Tuesday game. No Wednesday football this week, but we're back to Tuesday. It's the shitty, terrible Cowboys versus the COVID-19 Ravens. This team has gotten a lot of their guys back, thankfully, but it's been a rough few weeks for these guys. I don't really know how much they've actually practiced. Let's look at the Vegas line here for this game. Dallas at Baltimore. Dallas is 3-8. Baltimore is 6-5. Baltimore, this is a big, big, big game for them. They do not want to fall to 6-6. They need to win this game. They're minus 372 favorites at 78% win probability, and they're 8.5 point favorites. 45 total, relatively low scoring game. You have Baltimore, who hasn't been really performing too well lately, and Dallas, you know, we all know about Dallas. So, look, there's not a whole lot to talk about with this game. I don't see Dallas competing at all. In my opinion, Baltimore, they've been shit on. Everybody's kind of talking shit about them. They had a really tough game, you know, last week against the Steelers. RG3 gets injured. Trace McSorley comes in and throws a touchdown pass to Hollywood Brown randomly. I think with Lamar Jackson coming back, basically everyone's coming back except for, you know, we'll get into that in a second, but Mark Andrews and Snead probably not going to play. What do you think about the spread here, the total, and what do you think about this game just in general? What are you leaning towards?
I think this is about right. I think they're giving Dallas a lot of points, but I guess they have the ability to put up 18 with Andy Dalton back there at quarterback. I think this is similar to kind of what we saw against Pittsburgh. This is the secondary for the Baltimore Ravens is probably the second best part of their entire team as a whole.
Yeah, they did great against the Steelers. They really did.
Right, and this isn't. This is a similar wide receiver core, right? You got three guys who can go out there and make a huge difference. So I really think this game is going to come down to whether or not Baltimore's defense is up for the challenge there. And honestly, it makes it for interesting DFS picks too, because I think you're going to have – I think there is the potential to have one of these superstar receivers kind of break out on the Dallas side of the ball.
Yeah.
With at least a decent amount of points to be in the optimal. So – I like this game. I think it's going to be an ass whooping.
Look,
this is a great get right game for John Harbaugh and the Baltimore Ravens. They win this, and they can finish the season 10-6, 11-5, and secure a pretty decent playoff seating. So I think they're okay.
This is their opportunity, man. I feel like they're going to just come out and absolutely crush. They're going to get back their swag, and you know, Lamar Jackson, he's been shit on recently. Not only has he not been with his teammates, he's been in COVID protocol. He just hasn't played well before that. So we have to think about, look, this guy is the reigning MVP. He's got a lot of pride. there's no way he's not going to come out and absolutely crush this terrible Cowboys team, in my opinion. You know, typically with Lamar on a showdown slate, he's, you know, 13,000 plus, and we'll get into his pricing here in a minute. But I feel like he is an absolute lock in the flex this week. There's no doubt about it with his rushing upside and just generally speaking. I know we don't like to do narratives when it comes to DFS, but I just can't avoid it when it comes to this game. So let's take a look at the injuries here. Not a whole lot to talk about. We've got Mark Andrews, doubtful for COVID. Willie Snead, doubtful, COVID. they're probably not going to play, but, you know, just keep an eye on it. We've seen stranger things happen. Like, one of them being CEH starts a fucking game and I have 100% of him and he sits on the damn sideline because he's got the shits. That was fun. We won't even bring that up, but and
that was like, rough, man.
Yeah, that was terrible. Looks like the Cowboys really have no fantasy injuries of note. So with Mark Andrews and Willie Snead out, I actually kind of like it. I love Mark Andrews, and if he was playing, I would be getting a lot of him. But with Willie Snead out, I really, really like that because we just don't know what to expect from Snead. So anything jump out to you? How are you handling those injuries?
Yeah, I mean, look, I think it's going to open up a lot of opportunities to build a little bit differently as opposed to having all the ownership go Mark Andrews' direction. So I think it's going to open up a little bit of value elsewhere in the slate. And then again, Willie Snead, I think I'm probably going to eat my words on this one, but last week we didn't see what's his fucking name step up and fill that role that we thought he was going to fill with Willie Snead out.
DuVernay or Boykin? Oh, Boykin, right?
But yeah, Miles Boykin.
Yeah.
I honestly think he's the same guy, and I think we might see that those opportunities creep back up because, again, we're going to get Lamar back. So I think it's going to be interesting, and I think there's a lot of value that we're going to have across the slate.
So I'm just going to be honest with you guys. This game is not going to require a very long episode. There's not a whole lot to talk about. Play Ravens, play Lamar, and mix it up from there. But we're going to just get into this breakdown right away here. Break it down! All right, so let's get over to quarterback. So we've got Lamar Jackson at 11.6K, which is probably the lowest I've seen him in 2 years, you know, this year and last year. Andy Dalton at 10K. I don't know who's smoking crack when they're building these salaries here. This is fucking stupid. 10K for him. He needs to be around 95, 96. I know he's a serviceable backup and can go out and throw for 250 yards, one touchdown, and an interception, but he does not deserve to be 10K. So how are you handling Lamar? I mean, look, he's 1.6K more than Andy Dalton. That's just insane. He should be 13.4K or 13.2K. I know he's been struggling, but there's no reason why he shouldn't be that expensive. I think he's $2,000 under price minimum.
Yeah, I agree. I'm really worried. I mean, we've seen some pretty chalky games with some of these quarterbacks. I think we got 80% Josh Allen tonight. We've seen, 95% Patrick Mahomes on nights.
Yeah.
I mean, at that price tag, this could be like a 95% ownership. I don't understand how he's priced where he's at. I'd say 12.5 at minimum. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
But I think it's going to be pretty easy to build with him in the flex. And I think you're not going to have to get as crazy to get different because that price tag, you might have 35% of the field just jam into captain because he's such an obvious high ceiling play.
And there's no one else to choose from. Like when we were deciding on our Crown Their Ass segment captains tonight, for the first time I just didn't have a solid opinion because there's just no one really that sticks out. And the players that do stick out are going to be 30% in the captain, like Lamar. Like, I would love to play Lamar in the captain. Just, I don't, there's no chance that I could be unique with him in there.
Yeah, I agree. And I don't think you have a chance of being unique. If he's under 30% owned in the captain spot, then I'll be pretty surprised. But no, I'm going to lock him in every single lineup. Just like I did Josh Allen tonight. Like, I don't give a shit if that means I get zero Andy Dalton. I'll take that. I don't want to play Andy Dalton at all. Again, you're up against a pretty good defense and a very strong secondary. Andy Dalton's not a guy known for his accuracy or just his, you know, prowess at the quarterback position in general. So, and given the fact that they don't even have a starting offensive line, like, I know we don't do many injuries, but I don't think they have, they've started a different offensive line every week this year. So, I'm more worried that Andy Dalton may not make it through the game than I am that he's going to have a ceiling game.
Yeah. I mean, look, he played well against Minnesota and they won a game randomly. He had 20 fantasy points. And look, if he comes out and gets you 20 fantasy points, then yeah, that's a great play. I just don't see it happening in this game. I absolutely don't see it happening. What I do see happening is him throwing 30-plus times because they can't run the ball against this team. But they're throwing 30-plus times and not really doing much. I just don't see them... I don't see them scoring more than two touchdowns in this game. So when I'm building, I'm trying to find those lone two touchdowns, and I just don't think Andy Dalton's really involved in either of them. I think Zeke Elliott is probably, I know it's a, you know, he's pretty much matchup proof in my opinion, and with Andy Dalton back, I think he's actually able to run the ball a little bit more. So let's get right over into the running backs. Let's just do this. So we got Zeke Elliott at 10.2K. So, look, I'd rather get in every single lineup, I'd rather get Zeke Elliott over Dalton. That's just my opinion. And I think that Zeke Elliott's ownership is going to be a little bit lower. It's going to be high because there's no one else to play in this game. I mean, there's the wide receivers, but for the Cowboys. But when it comes to Zeke, I'd rather get him in every lineup over Dalton. And you got Tony Pollard at 2,600. He's always a weapon when it comes to catching the ball to the backfield, getting a couple long random runs. So with these two guys, they're heavy underdogs. They're not going to be winning this game. How can Zeke Elliott and Tony Pollard, make it into the optimal? How can they have a successful game?
I think Tony Pollard has the opportunity just because he's going to get involved in the pass game a little bit more. And when you're wide receivers are struggling against some pretty strong man coverage, I think it's an easy way to kind of get a mismatch on the defensive side of the ball. So I think Tony Pollard might be able to get there given that situation. But again, it's relying upon Andy Dalton. I don't think he's going to get the rushing attempts to get there. Zeke Elliott's matchup proof. And I mean, shit, 10,200, that's still a little bit low for me, even against a good defense like this, right?
Yeah.
I think he should be closer to 11,000, just any slate. It doesn't really matter because he has the potential to hit 200 yards and three touchdowns. I mean, he's one of the top four backs in the NFL, and I don't give a shit what anybody says.
Yeah.
Right. He's getting volume, and he's doing decent without an offensive line.
Yeah.
So imagine if they get some consistent play and some decent push up front, he's looking at another touchdown on top of already 100-yard performance night. So, yeah, Ezekiel Elliott's always in play for me. Tony Pollard, I really just don't – I don't think I'm going to be stretching that far. I'd rather punt on the Ravens side of the ball because I think they're going to have the most opportunities on offense.
I mean, Tony Pollard at 2,600 is still a pretty good option, to be honest. I actually kind of like him. I just – you know, it's a 70-30 split with between Zeke and Pollard. I just don't know at 30% of the snaps. And, you know, Tony Pollard runs less routes than Zeke. Zeke still runs routes. And if we look at targets, Zeke gets more targets. So I'd rather just stick with Zeke and not try to, like, I know a lot of times on this show we talk about double running back lineups to be unique. And it's a possibility. Maybe I'll have one like that or two out of 20 or 40 lineups. But to me, Pollard is just, it's reaching a little bit too much. But I do like his price. So, you know, hear me out when I say me personally, I might avoid him a little bit. But I think he's still a pretty good play at that price. So let's move on to the other side of the ball, Baltimore. Now, this is interesting here. This is going to be tough to figure this out. So... obviously we have J.K. Dobbins is back. He took over as the number one guy before all this shit hit the fan. I think he had 60%+ of the snaps, and he had a majority of the rushing percentage for the team. Excuse me. So J.K. Dobbins was, you know, he was on track to be the number one guy and really take over. And then all this shit hit the fan, and that sort of he took a step back because Gus Edwards had a few good games. Gus Edwards has been looking really good. Justice Hill has been looking really good. Mark Ingram, we haven't seen him in a minute. I'm just not interested in Mark Ingram. I used to be a huge Mark Ingram fan. I still like Mark Ingram as a player, but fantasy wise, I don't want it. I don't want to see him in any of my lineups. So to me personally, it's Edwards, Dobbins, and Hill, and Justice Hill. But Gus Edwards at 5,400. I feel like he's going to get the majority of the snaps. You got J.K. Dobbins coming back. We don't know what to expect from him. I don't think they're going to try to force him in. You know, he's their future running back. I don't think they're going to try to force him in when you got Gus Edwards, who has played the last few games and played well. You got J.K. Dobbins at 8,600. To me, I feel like J.K. Dobbins is going to be pretty high owned because everyone just assumes he's the guy. But I think you can find some huge leverage by going with Gus Edwards in this game. And even a couple sprinkled in Justice Hill lineups may be a possibility. So how are you handling this? Are we on the same page with this? Like, what are your thoughts with the order of snaps and carries here? Is it Edwards, Dobbins, then maybe Mark Ingram?
If the Chiefs didn't fucking play last night, I'd say it'd be Dobbins, Edwards, Ingram, Hill. But, I don't know, man. They may be fucking hesitant to play some of these guys just because they could still have lingering effects, and that may impact J.K. Dobbins' playing time a little bit. Yeah. So I think Gus Edwards gets the bump for me. And look, honestly, I'm probably going to have a healthy exposure to both these guys. I don't think you're doing anything. If you don't have Lamar Jackson and the captain, just fucking throw Lamar, Gus Edwards, and J.K. Dobbins. I mean, shit, throw in Mark Ingram and Justice Hill, too. Like, all of the rushing game on Baltimore side of the ball, right? Like, I don't think this is a bad game to just play every running back on the slate and Lamar Jackson. Yeah. And that includes Ezekiel Elliott, right? So, I'm right there with you. I love Gus Edwards at 5,400. And with J.K. Dobbins coming back, I think his ownership might slip a little bit.
Big time.
Or Gus Edwards.
Yeah.
Because you're right. Everybody thinks he's the one. And, yeah, he probably is the one RB1 there. But, again, this isn't a situation where I think that they're going to need to leverage that part of the backfield to stay competitive. So, I'll have exposure to a lot of J.K. Dobbins, a lot of Gus Edwards. I don't think I need Justice Hill. I don't know if he's going to get the time.
Yeah.
And Mark Ingram slowly being phased out of the offense. Yeah. And I think that actually came from Harbaugh. Or I don't know, man. It was on fucking Twitter. So who knows?
Yeah.
But still, he's being phased out of the offense at that price tag again. I'd just rather go with Gus Edwards. Gus has the ability to even vulture on the goal line if J.K. Dobbins does get a majority of the workload.
Yeah.
So I love him. I love him in this game.
This is totally a situation if you wanted to go four Ravens players, you go Gus, J.K., Lamar, and the Ravens defense even. Like, you're talking about all the rushing that you could possibly expect. And, of course, as soon as you do a lineup like that, you know, Ingram scores two touchdowns, of course. But generally speaking, like, getting Lamar with two running backs from this team, like, I actually like that roster construction quite a bit because we just haven't seen the passing game excel much at all this season. I expect it to eventually get better. I just don't know if that's going to happen now. We know for a fact they can run the ball. Doesn't matter who the quarterback is. So if Lamar's back, it's going to, their run game is going to be much better. So anyways, that's just, it's tough. It's really tough to figure this out. I'm actually just going to take a stand and say, look, I think that Gus Edwards is the guy. That's just my opinion on it. I don't think he will necessarily get the most rushing attempts, but at that price at 5,400, especially you throw him in the captain, you can put everybody else in the flex that you would want for sure. Anything else to add to this before we move on?
No, bro. I'm right there with you.
All right. So let's go over to the Baltimore wide receivers. So, you know, you got Hollywood Brown, Marquise Brown at 7,200. He had, you know, Trace McSorley threw the ball up to him. He caught it and got a random touchdown. Lucky as hell. I think that, you know, Marquise worked hard for that touchdown, and it was nice to see him score it because he's been struggling quite a bit. But it wasn't really indicative of how he's been actually playing. So, you know, you see week five, he had a 19-point game, and then last week he had an 18-point game, and then week one he had an 18-point game. So he's really only had three good games this year, and those good games weren't amazing. They were just good enough to, like, say, all right, well, he paid off his salary. Last week he was 5,200, and now they boosted him all the way up to 7,200 because of that one play. I just don't like that. I think he should still be in that 5 to 6K range. Moving him up to 7,200 is a little too much, in my opinion. There's just no one else to play on this slate. I think that's why they're doing it. Like, there's not a lot of players to actually choose from. This is going to be a tough, tough slate to build. Because, look, if Marquise Brown doesn't go off, I don't know who does. Dez Bryant is at 1,000. Hasn't really done shit. He was targeted, you know, five times a few weeks ago. It hasn't really translated into a lot of fantasy points or just output in general. You got Devin DuVernay, who's definitely a dynamic player, and I've been pretty high on him. It's just he just doesn't get enough opportunity. He's like, you know, Cordero Patterson, like last year when he wasn't getting running back attempts. He, you know, on occasion he'll catch a couple passes here and there. I just don't think he has a huge threat for a touchdown when it comes to actually offensively. Miles Boykin at 600, like you said, I actually like Miles Boykin at 600 a lot. This is popping out to me now. $600 for him with no Snead. Who the fuck else are they going to throw it to? They don't have Mark Andrews. Like, Marquise Brown isn't necessarily crushing it with his routes. So, Ellie, how do you handle these four guys here? Is there anybody else in the player pool to talk about? No, not really. So how are you handling these four guys? Who are you prioritizing, if any?
Yeah, honestly, I may rotate my two running back quarterback stack with one of these guys and just maybe have one lineup with each of them.
Yeah.
Just to keep it real simple. I don't mind Miles Boykin as just a pure punt at $800.
Mm-hmm.
He got zero targets last week. He really didn't get involved in the game. I think he did have one target that was kind of on a penalty or on a holding call or something.
You just can't judge it, though, because you got RG3 throwing. He can't throw a damn ball, you know?
Right. And again, he's got a little bit more chemistry working with Lamar Jackson. We've seen them kind of get that love. And I know to anybody who actually, you know, watches the full show here, you're going to say, well, RG3 got, I called out the last time, RG3 gets some practice with these, you know, these backups. But yeah, give me some credit here. RG3 is old as hell. Somehow he got injured during the game, and that impacted it. Lamar Jackson's a good young quarterback. I think he's going to try to get one of these guys involved. And Marquise Brown, he's not a bad play. Again, I just don't know who you're going to spend money on this slate. My captain isn't one of these expensive chalky guys. It's not going to be J.K. Dobbins, Lamar Jackson. So that's kind of what we're referring to when we're talking about, you know, who are we going to pay for? Again, I don't want to just start playing punts and end up leaving $8,000 on the table because, you know what I mean? Like, I still want to play some of these safer plays. So if it comes down to it, and my captain's a low chalk enough, then I might try and jam in some of the higher ceiling guys. And I like Marquise Brown. He does have the ceiling, but again, you might get a little bit of recency bias with that you know, breakout play that he had. And I expect his ownership to come in accordingly. So I'm okay with kind of limiting my exposure, but I'll have some in there just in case some shit like that happens again. The other guys, Dez Bryant, they're all cheap, you know, get some exposure. I'm not going to get too crazy with it. I think this is a good opportunity for Baltimore to run the ball.
So, you know, you want to know a crazy stat here, a crazy number. So, do you think that Russell Wilson's old? Like, just if we talk about Russell Wilson, do you think he's an old guy? Like, would you consider him old?
I'd say, like, he's going to be, like, 31, right?
Russell Wilson's 32. Guess how old, how old RG3 is.
He's going to be, like, what, 34, 35?
He's 30. He's younger than Russell Wilson by two years.
Bro, yeah, but his fucking...
His knee ACL is like six is like, years older. Like 64, yeah. Well, I heard that stat. I heard that on the broadcast for the RG3 game, you know, Wednesday night or whatever that was. And I couldn't fucking believe it. I could not believe that he's younger than Russell Wilson. It's just crazy. It's crazy to me. That just shows how much potential he had. And he's just been an afterthought for like 5, 6, 7 years at this point.
Bro, like, I want to, like, so... And not to digress too much here, but so like Josh Allen, he like think about it. Think about the leap that he year over year. This dude's like what 20 fucking 1, like 21 years old, 22 years old.
Yeah,
like dude, we're gonna have some good quarterbacks in the league for a while.
Oh yeah,
it's gonna be fun to watch. Like remember when RG3 and you know Kirk Cousins on those guys came out in that same draft? Like RG3 was supposed to be the second coming, but like the quarterbacks we've been getting over the past 3 years. They're pretty fucking remarkable.
And don't forget about Lamar, dude.
Yeah, you know? Dude, Lamar, Patrick Mahomes, Josh Allen, even Kyler Murray. Like, there's a lot of guys out there that are fucking... I mean, dude, Drew Locke, what did he complete, like, 3 passes yesterday? I mean, good for him. All right,
I'm done. All right, let's move over to the wide receivers for the Cowboys. All right, there's a bunch of dudes here. You got Amari Cooper at 9,600. He's still the number one guy, no matter what people want to say about CeeDee Lamb. CeeDee Lamb is, you know, up and coming. He has, you know, I think next year he'll probably be the number one guy, and maybe the year after that, who knows. CeeDee Lamb is 6,600. Michael Gallup is 4,400. Cedric Wilson, 1,200. And the rest of these guys I'm not even going to mention. Noah Brown, maybe $200. So... how are you handling this? This is going to be tough to figure out here. I mean, I'm not going to get a lot of Andy Dalton, in my opinion. So how can I play more than one of these guys in the flex? Especially considering this is probably going to be a lower scoring game. Do I bank on garbage time receptions? Maybe. To me, Michael Gallup sticks out at 4,400. Amari Cooper is just too expensive to me unless he gets you 2 touchdowns in this game. How are you handling these 4 guys here? Like, do we just spread it out kind of like what we did on the other side of the ball with the Ravens? Like, what do you think?
Yeah, that's really going to be my strategy here, man. I think we're going to run into a similar situation where we're not sure who we're going to pay up for. You get a lot of flexibility with your salary with, you know, some of these mid-range captains here that I think you can kind of, you might be able to jam in Amari Cooper. I mean, that would mean you probably would get less Ezekiel Elliott, but, you know, I'm okay with a couple lineups like that. But I'm going to have to look into where Amari Cooper is going to play. We may end up having an old Alabama versus Alabama matchup here.
You son of a bitch.
Amari Cooper and Marlon Humphrey, man, that's going to be a fun battle to watch. But yeah. I expect Marlon Humphrey to be on CeeDee Lamb, right, because he's a much more big physical guy. And we'll probably see Marcus Peters shadow Amari Cooper. So it'll be an interesting night. Like, I'm really interested in watching how this matchup plays out, dude. And yeah. I'm going to have a little bit of exposure to both these guys, and that's – or to all three of these key wide receivers, just because they have the explosive ability to make things happen. And one thing that they can do to really get these guys involved is to stop fucking relying on Andy Dalton to throw it 35 yards on the field and just start running some screen passes, yeah. Right? Take some stress off of him and let your playmakers do something.
Yeah.
Amari Cooper is a clean route runner, man. Like he can get separation on a 3-yard route. So I think you have the ability to take advantage of some opportunities like that. because you're probably going to have Baltimore defense bailing out to stop the run. So if you can start completing some of these quick passes and getting Amari Cooper, CeeDee Lamb open on their own, open in the field over the middle or something like that, I think they have the opportunity to make some plays. But again, I don't think you're going to need to get more than one wide receiver from the Dallas side of the ball in your lineup. I think only one will get there. I just don't know if they're going to have enough volume to get multiples of these guys. To pay off.
And as we're talking,
I like Amari Cooper.
As we're talking about this, I'm just having flashbacks of a random game where the Cowboys come out and just fucking crush. You know, I don't think it's gonna happen, but it's like this team is talented. I know they have a lot of injuries, but like, when are they gonna actually have a big game from two or three of these wide receivers? It's gotta happen, right? I mean, I don't know. To me, I'm not going to go heavy on wide receivers here. I'm going to pick one. It just scares me because all three of these guys are talented. If you look at Michael Gallup, if you've watched the show before and you watch Cowboys breakdowns from us, I always like Michael Gallup for whatever fucking reason. Last week, Amari Cooper had 100% of the snaps. Michael Gallup had 79 and CeeDee Lamb had 77. So, you know, Michael Gallup had an extra snap or two. They all ran around the same amount of routes. But if you go back to week 11, Amari Cooper had 85% of the snaps. Michael Gallup had 87. CeeDee Lamb had 66. So look, there is a world where Michael Gallup is on the field more than Amari Cooper. And if they use him the way they should, a couple screen passes, a couple slant plays, and a random fade here and there, I think Michael Gallup has a path to be one of the highest scoring players on this slate. But, you know, it's wishful thinking for me. For me, at 4,400, it's worth a shot. Get Michael Gallup and Zeke Elliott in your lineup for your two Cowboys and run it back with four from Baltimore. I think that's a pretty good core. You know, like Michael Gallup at 4,400, Zeke at 10.2, that actually gets you some decent value and you can pay up on the other side of the ball. So anything else to drop on? I mean, what do you think about Gallup? Do you like Gallup at all?
Yeah, man. I like Gallup a lot. I just, again, my thing is if I have enough salary to get to CD or Amari, I'm just going to end up paying for those two.
Yeah.
Just because it's a little bit safer, right? I'm looking, we want Michael Gallup to kind of have a ceiling output. And I don't know if, just the way that I've been building so far, I just don't know that I need to dip that low into the salary to fill out my position. So we'll see. But I like him. He's a fine play.
All right, so let's move over to the tight ends here. You got Dalton Schultz at 5,200. I know he's a starting tight end for this team. 5,200 seems pretty high for him, right? I mean, Dalton Schultz, he's not really one of these dynamic players. Now, if you look at some of his previous scores, it's not bad. I mean, he's got a 22-point game. He's got a 17-point game, 11, 12. That's pretty good. Look, this guy's no scrub. I just feel like 5,200 just doesn't really fit him. Like, I don't know. I mean, if you look at his previous costs, he's 6,200, then he goes down to, you know, 36. And so he fluctuates quite a bit. So this is kind of the middle of the road for him at salary. And like I said, you probably don't need the salary. Like, you don't have to worry about salary on this slate necessarily. But with Dalton Schultz, just doesn't really do anything for me, right? Like, how do you feel about him?
Yeah, I'm cool with not getting much Dalton Schultz. Again, if I'm taking players from the Cowboys in general, I want Zeke, I want Amari, CeeDee Lamb, even Michael Gallup. Those are really my four guys. I don't know if I really want anything else. And Dalton Schultz isn't going to be that guy. Yeah. It just if you want a bullshit narrative, I mean, Eric Ebron, he was pretty impressive last week against Baltimore.
Yeah.
Again, this is a proud defense. I don't think they're going to come out and let fucking backup Dalton come beat their ass. You know what I mean? So I don't think he's going to get the volume, and I don't think he's going to get the run at all.
So this might be the worst tight end player pool we've ever seen. You got Dalton Schultz as your best tight end on the slate. You got Luke Wilson at 1,800. Dude should have caught a touchdown pass last week.
Bro, so, yeah, first of all, this isn't the worst tight end player pool. At least they have one this week.
Yeah, you know? That's true.
Yeah, hey, would you have to, like, manually add him? I think I had to go in and, like, put him into my lineups if I wanted him.
Well, I guess my point is the slate. There's no tight ends that I would consider even playing on this slate. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true. And usually we're high on tight ends, you know? I'm okay with Luke Wilson, I guess. But again, I think one problem we're going to run into is, you know, do we really need to pay down like that?
Yeah.
I don't think we're going to have to dip that far into our salary pool to be able to get the builds that we want. So, you know, he's in the player pool if I absolutely need to. But Eric Tomlinson, I don't even know what the fuck that is.
He's former Jet, he just jumps around all over the place. Tomlinson at $200. I'm not even considering him. He's not going to be in my player pool. I will have a few shares of Luke Wilson. I think people will slightly remember the fact that he almost caught a touchdown pass. And look, it was in his hands, but it was stripped out. I don't know who it was from the opposing team's defense, but it was stripped out of his hands. It was a tough catch. He didn't just drop it. But I think people will remember seeing that on a Wednesday afternoon or whatever that was. And potentially...
I think it was Minka Fitzpatrick from... Guess who? Roll Tide.
You son of a bitch.
So, look, Luke Wilson, if his ownership is above 15%, or 20 maybe, I don't want to touch him. But if he's low-owned, I'll throw a couple dart throws with him. All right. So, kickers in defense. So, look, we got Justin Tucker at 4K straight up. Greg Zuerlein at 3,600. And then you have Ravens defense at 5,800. So, pretty well, that's not a bad price for them. And then you have the Cowboys defense at 3,200. Now, the only reason why you'd consider maybe playing the Dallas Cowboys defense is you don't think Lamar is really fully back and maybe... it's just going to be a super low-scoring game. Maybe he makes a mistake. Are we going to get a lot of defense? Like, are we going to get a lot of Ravens defense and kickers just because there's no one else to fucking play?
Yeah, I think so. I think people are going to be a little higher on Justin Tucker than they usually are. If I'm being honest with you, I don't think you need the Ravens kicker in this particular case. I think you can go with... Who's the kicker on the other side of the ball? What the fuck's
his name? Greg the Leg.
Oh, yeah, Greg the Leg. Yeah, Greg the Leg, I mean, he's fine. If they get yardage and stall out, he could be the source of all the points for Dallas. So I don't think he's a bad play, but I would stack that with the Ravens defense. Justin Tucker, I mean, he's fine. He's going to get you some yardage. Again, I just don't know. If I need to dip that low into salary, I think there's other value plays that are going to have more potential on the slate. And, if you're playing cash, I think he's going to give you a consistent floor. But I don't know that he's going to be out there kicking field goals all night. And then in Dallas, if you play their defense, man, I just hope you fucking take down the middle because that's really the only reason I could.
Ballsy, yeah.
I could think of doing something like that. Sure, you may get a couple sacks because this is a running offense, right? You're going to have the quarterback scrambling around, so if they score that, you're in your favor. But I just don't see him taking anything back for six.
I'd rather get Tony Pollard, you know? Like, I'd rather just go with Tony Pollard, you know? Like, there's no reason to play him.
Fucking with the $800 wide receiver, like, you know what I mean? Like, if you're going to punt, just fucking get rid of the salary and go play the best guys you can.
All right, let's get over to our fate of the night. Play the sound. Go up. What? What's up?
It was Minka Fitzpatrick. I looked it up.
It was? Okay. All right.
What's your name?
Tony!
Fuck you, Tony!
Ellie, what's your fate of the night, bro?
Yeah, Marquise Brown, man. I think he's going to come in a little bit more popular just because of some of the run that he got at the end of the game there. You know, I don't want much of the passing attack on the Ravens side of the ball.
Yeah.
I think there's other options to go with, and he's just not my guy.
Yeah, I think he's priced up too much a little bit, you know. I mean, look, maybe he just needed that confidence and he come out and actually play well. Maybe him and Lamar are vibing a little bit better. Who knows what's going on? But I kind of tend to agree with you. If he's overinflated with his ownership, I'm going to be under. I'm going to get some shares of him, though, because you just have to. Because he's the kind of guy who can and will break the slate randomly with a, you know, like with a 70-something yard touchdown. Like, that's just something he does. For me, I'm fading Andy Dalton. There's really no... I mean, I don't really need to get too deep into this. Like, I think we all understand why I would fade, or anybody would fade, Andy Dalton. I just don't think he has an opportunity to actually do well. I think he's going to make mistakes. He's going to be harassed from the defense quite a bit. And look, there's nothing for this team to play for. I just think they're going through the motions. Andy Dalton is my fade of the night. And typically with my fades of the night, I go just like under the field, but in this case, I might uncheck him just to be different and focus on getting, you know, one or two of the wide receivers in my lineup. Ellie, are you still there? You look like your camera's all fucked up. Jesus H. Yeah. All right. Well, as long as you're still there.
I can hear him. I don't know why it's fucking white noise.
All right. Danny Green, take us to our crown their ass segment.
Now, if you want to crown them, then crown their ass.
All right, dude. We're both going with Gus Edwards here. Explain yourself, and then I'll chime in.
Yeah, dude. I just think I think he's gonna get overlooked. His price is nice, and even if he's just playing RB2 behind J.K. Dobbins, I still think there's an opportunity for him to get enough work to pay off. And here's the thing, is I want all the offense from Baltimore, and he allows you to do that. Everyone's going to have Lamar captain. If you don't, you're probably going to have Dobbin the captain, or Zeke, right? I assume that that's how it's going to go. So with Gus Edwards, you're probably going to be less than 4% at the captain spot, and you can play Lamar, you can play Zeke, you can play Amari, you can play literally anybody you want. You'll be able to fit him in. That's really my thinking.
This is just a straight-up leverage play for me. I think people are going to overreact to the fact that Dobbins is back. And maybe, you know, as we can tell with these coaches, you know, with CEH sitting on the bench, yeah, they're active. J.K. Dobbins is active. It doesn't mean he's going to even see the field. Yeah, I think he's going to see the field. But, like, who's going to see the field more? And to me, I feel like Gus Edwards can have those opportunities to actually – he's going to be in the goal line most likely – I don't think they're going to work Ingram in too much. I think they like Gus Edwards, and so do I. And at that price, and I know for a fact his ownership is going to be low in the captain. Like, there's no way that he's above 5% in the captain. There's just no fucking way. So when I see all that information adding up, it's, okay, look, there's a chance he gets, you know, 42 yards and 2 receptions or something. My night's over, but I'm probably going to have 80% Gus Edwards, and then I'll take some in the captain, and then I'll take some dart throws somewhere else. What do you think about that? What do you think your exposure is going to be in the captain? I know we have to wait for ownership and all that shit, but what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, he'll be my highest owned captain. The only person I'll be looking at specifically is going to be Dobbins. If his ownership comes in too crazy low, then I might look at him at the captain spot, but again, that's going to start fucking with pricing just a little bit. At 8,600, though, he isn't terrible, so I think he's viable if his ownership comes in low enough. But I just think Gus Edwards is going to get all the work. And here's the thing, is people are going to shy off of it naturally just because it's scary with Mark Ingram in there. They can go off for 130 and 2 touchdowns whenever he's on the field. So I get it. I think this is just an easy leverage play.
All right, let's build a lineup, dude. Let's do this. So we have the DraftKings browser up here. I don't think there's any doubt as to who we're going to build a lineup with in the captain. Let's see if I can find him. It's a little harder on – it's hard to build. Like, I don't think I've ever built a lineup on this – like, on the desktop version of DraftKings. Have you? Because I sure as
hell. No, dude, it's so frustrating. The site sucks too. Like, it was
built specifically
for mobile.
It's terrible. And even for mobile, it sucks. Fuck. What's his name? Gus Edwards.
All right. There you go.
All right, let's throw him in the captain. All right, so we got to do a 4-2 here, right? We don't want to do a 3-3 in this game. I don't think so, right?
Yeah, I'm cool with 4-2, even 5-1. So
all right. So let's go Lamar. Let's go Dobbins, right? Do you agree with this so far?
Yes.
Okay. So who are we gonna get? Let's do one Cowboy. We gotta go Zeke, right? Can we just plug Zeke in?
Let's do it.
Look at that. You got 5,700 remaining still. That's pretty impressive. All right. So look. Who are we targeting on the Ravens now? We have all the running attacks. Do we want to go to Boykin? Do we want to go to one guy who can catch the ball? What do you think?
Yeah, man. Like, honestly, I don't think you're in it. I don't think we can throw in fucking Hollywood Brown just for the hell of it. You know what I mean? Like, he's cheap enough for this build that it's not awful, right? And,
what if we try
Luke Wilson?
Yeah, we could do Luke Wilson. What if we tried Boykin?
Yeah, dude.
That leaves us with 10-9. We might not even need to play Boykin. Yeah, this is exactly what you were talking about. Like, at what point do we just not need to like go down this low? Let's try Marquise Brown and see. Okay, 4,300. This is going to be a kicker situation. This is going to be like Greg the Leg or Pollard, you know? So I would rather get one of the wide receivers for Dallas. Like we talked about it. We should get CD. Cooper. I don't think we can get Amari Cooper unless we do go low. Can we get Luke Wilson? Dude, we can get Luke Wilson here with this lineup. Let's do this. You see what I'm doing? I got Amari Cooper. Yeah. I got Zeke Elliott and Amari Cooper. And then you have Gus Edwards in the captain, Lamar Jackson and Dobbins. And then we go down to Luke Wilson. That's a sick lineup, dude. It's a sick fucking lineup, in my opinion.
I agree, dude. I think you're going to get all the – I mean, here's the thing. You don't need a wide receiver necessarily. You don't even really need the pass catcher on the Ravens side of the ball with Lamar Jackson. But having Luke Wilson kind of gives you that, like, 6% owned guy that has the opportunity to catch a touchdown in the end zone like we saw last week.
Yeah.
And nobody's going to have this build, dude. And you fade Andy Dalton, you're still getting probably a majority of the offense on Dallas.
Yeah. I mean, look, if you wanted to go – to one of these Baltimore wide receivers, if you wanted to get Hollywood Brown, maybe you can. Let's just try this. You go Hollywood Brown. Fuck is this guy? And then you go cheap on the other side. You go cheap on Dallas. Can we get? Where's he at? Gallup. Damn, that's so close. We were $100 away from Gallup. That would have worked out really well. Who's our second favorite wide receiver on the Ravens? Is it Boykin?
Yeah, dude. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't fucking know. And I think it is Boykin.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't know but what is Des Bryant? $1,000? Like, honestly, that's not terrible. And he saw what, 5 targets last week?
Yeah. Yeah. So look, okay. So if you could do Cooper here, it's just, look, just play with this stuff. That first lineup I liked a lot more, but this, you know, I like the core of Edwards, Jackson, and Dobbins and Zeke Elliott, and then from there I'm gonna differentiate those last two positions. I might actually just have that core in a lot of my lineups and then kind of just figure out those last two positions. And you look, if Gus Edwards sucks, then whatever, I'll go to the next slate.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty easy core. Again, Gus Edwards needs to get there, but I can see him easily getting there. And this is an easy one to fade J.K. Dobbins too. If you think Gus Edwards is the man and J.K. is not going to play at all, get rid of him. 8,600, go Ezekiel Elliott and fucking CeeDee Lamb and I don't know. You can do whatever you want. You can literally play whoever you want with Gus Edwards at captain. Apparently,
yeah. Yeah, you can. Exactly, because his ownership's going to be super low. All right, man. So what do you think about this game? Final score-wise, is this going to hit the under? Going to go over? Can the Ravens actually come back and have a statement game and stay in the playoff hunt?
Yeah, I think this is I think the Ravens are going to make a statement tomorrow night. I can see this game easily being 35-10.
Yeah, I think Lamar's going to come out and have a just he's going to crush. I think so. I think he's going to have two passing touchdowns, 250 yards passing, and 1 to 2 rushing touchdowns. That's just my opinion on it. And hopefully Gus Edwards is involved with that as well. But we'll see. We'll see. Good old Tuesday night football. Thank you, COVID. Thanks for joining us, guys. Throw us a like. And we'll see you for Thursday night football. See you guys later.